Welcome everybody, I'm Jacopo Fumagalli. I'm going to talk about stochastic background of gravitational waves from turns in the landscape. This research has been done in collaboration with these colleagues at the Institute of Astrophysics de Paris. Now, one of the key success of inflation is the fact that it provides an almost scale invariant power spectrum for the curvature fluctuation that well explain the temperature anisotropy in the cosmic microwave background. Now, what observation of the cosmic microwave background constraint is actually the power spectrum over a limited range of scale. And assuming that the power spectrum will continue to behave like this up to arbitrary small scale, can be seen as a huge extrapolation. And in fact, what my wonder, what about some enhancement of the curvature fluctuation due to some dynamics at a later stage during the inflationary dynamics, and it's very tempting to do that because it leads to potentially a lot of interesting physics. In fact, this enhancement of the curvature fluctuation will lead eventually during radiation domination to primordial black holes or to a stochastic background of gravitational waves potentially detectable by LISA. Now, there are various ideas and many scenarios where you can have this enhancement of curvature fluctuation, inflection point, Tuttle's rule. I just list a few here. Some of them are driven by the flow of the Hubble by the Hubble flow. What we are proposing here is a mechanism which act only in a multi-field context, so that is unique to multi-field, that it can have some theoretical advantages, and what I will try to stress, potentially some characteristic signature that therefore will act as a smoking gun to a multi-field dynamics that otherwise cannot be probed. And in this sense, I recommend also to see this other paper that came out at the same time as ours in April. Now, the plan for the talk is first to explain the mechanism that act during multi-field and especially what is inflation in non-geodesic motion, and then see how this mechanism can be used to generate primordial black holes or stochastic background of gravitational waves. Now, this is the generic action that you have in a multi-field scenario, where this GIJ is called the metric on field space, and coupled like this the kinetic term, and then a potential V. Now you can project the equation of motion along the direction orthogonal to the background trajectory, and the unit vector tangent to the background trajectory will satisfy this equation, where this is the covariant derivative with respect to this GIJ over the background. And then you see that this equation, what's telling you by introducing this parameter eta perp, is telling you that if eta perp is equal to zero, the trajectory, the inflow moves along a geodesics of field space. Otherwise, if it's different from zero, and especially the region we're interested in is when it's much bigger than one, the motion will be strongly non-geodesics. Now, the importance of this parameter eta perp is even more relevant at the level of the fluctuation. Here, again, you consider two fields model, where in this gauge I describe like this the entropic fluctuation, so the fluctuation orthogonal to the background trajectory, and the curvature fluctuation will play the role of the adiabatic fluctuation. And you see that eta perp couple at bilinear level the perturbation, and it's really the what serves the exchange between these two modes and basically carry the information about the multi-field dynamics. Now, if you look at the equation of the entropic fluctuation, you see the source terms from the curvature fluctuation, and you see a mass that we call entropic mass, which has three contributions. One is due to the potential, another one is due to the geometry, and then a negative one that comes from that is proportional to the bending parameter again. And from this, one can infer schematically that if the bending is much bigger than one, so if the motion is strongly non-geodesics, this mass square will become negative. So you will have a tachyonic instability on sub-horizon scale. This However, doesn't mean, and it's crucial, that the background is unstable. Because, in fact, if you look at the equation of the perturbation on super Hubble scale, you can integrate zeta with a first integral, and you see that the entropic perturbation will decouple and will have an effective mass, which is given by the entropic mass defined before, plus a term proportional to 4 and proportional to the bending. All of this to say that in a region where you have a strong bending, you can end up to have an entropic mass which is negative, although you have a background which is stable and the perturbation well behaving on superhorizon scale. And you can see this by looking at the evolution of the power spectrum. This is the time evolution of the power spectrum for a given k modes in a region where the entropic mass is negative due to a large bending. And you see the power spectrum as usual decay here. Then when there is the entropic mass crossing, it will be exponentially amplified, and then on superhorizon scale it will freeze and well behave here. So the exponential enhancement is only over a limited range of scale. Now you can wonder, now we use basically this idea to have an enhancement of the curvature fluctuation over a limited range of scale. So the big picture is the following. You have an inflaton that is moving in a generic potential and geometry along a geodesic of field space. At some point, it encounters a strong tone where the motion deviates from a geodesics, and this will lead to this transient tachyonic instability that will enhance the curvature fluctuation for a limited range of scale. What I want to stress here, you can do a model-independent treatment of the fluctuation given by these three functions, that there is no need, as many single-field proposal, for ultra-slow-roll phase, where you have to study, where you introduce a stochastic treatment and all the complication related, and there is not need for a waterfall phase, as in other scenario of multi-field inflation. There is no need for a waterfall phase precisely because the background is stable, as we remarked before. Now, this is the example. For example, you take a bending parameter which is given by a Gaussian profile. Here you have two Gaussian profile, one narrower than the other, and you see the resulting power spectrum over a given range of scale. You see that you can have this peak which is narrower when it's narrower the bending. And we went a step forward in the sense that there is an you can have an analytical understanding of this shape, which relate the microscopic physics with the position, the height of this power spectrum, the shape, how it decays, and especially, and I want to stress here, the growth of the power spectrum, because there are well-known theorem on single-field inflation on how much the power spectrum can grow, how much can be the steepness of the power spectrum, and this theorem can be evaded by the multi-field dynamics and can be explained analytically, so we can go beyond this theorem. To give an example of what can this leads to the mass distribution of prime order black hole, again, there is no time to discuss the mass distribution of prime order black hole, see Garcia, Bellindo, Tolkko, Ubi-Maier for explanation on that. So if you assume for the moment just Gaussian statistics of the curvature fluctuation, you can see that when for a steeper growth, this roughly phi is when you evade this bound on single field inflation, you have for the mass distribution of prime order black holes a narrower peak. That's just an example. And you can go even to sharper bending, which means that the typical time over which this bending happens is smaller than the Hubble scale, than the Hubble radius, sorry. And when you have this relation met, see also this paper, as I was saying before, you have typical oscillation in the power spectrum, typical oscillation pattern that are truly given by this excitation of the two quanta degrees of freedom involved in the game here. These at the level of the mass distribution of prime order black holes doesn't seem to have an effect because are washed out by the procedure at which you obtain this mass distribution, at least within the Gaussian approximation. But as we will show, they can potentially leaves interesting imprints in the gravitational wave spectrum. Now, before moving to the gravitational wave spectrum, I just want to stress, as is well known in the literature, that prime order black holes generation is a very rare phenomena, and therefore is sensitive to the tail of the distribution. So assuming the distribution is Gaussian is often not enough, and this is the hope for that we let for future work, is the fact that we study the non-Gaussianity in strongly non-geodesic motion, and we show that there is a hierarchical structure at every order on which you can classify the non-Gaussianity, peculiar type of non-Gaussianity and of flattened type in this kind of model. So the idea is to use this result to see if we lead to some characteristic or effects on the mass distribution of primordial black hole. This is a hope. Now, stochastic background of gravitational waves. So first of all, where these gravitational waves comes from? Well, simply you expand the Einstein equation to second order, and what you see is that the curvature fluctuation at linear order will act at second order as a source for the tensor mode, nothing more than that. And you can see schematically that hij will be given by a Green function times a transfer function, and they will be proportional to the power spectrum roughly. Now, in principle, each k mode of the hij undergoes the nonlinear dynamic of the curvature fluctuation. In practice, they are mostly enhanced when the curvature fluctuation re-enter the horizon. So to have a signal that will be detectable by LISA, this has to happen during radiation domination. And the reason, if you want, why this gravitational wave is stochastic is twofold. First, because the source is stochastic, and second, because during radiation domination, the typical size of the casual contact is much smaller than the Hubble radius today, so that the source is undistinguishable. Now, to make this a long story short, the gravitational wave spectrum, which is given by this formula, will just be roughly given by a convolution of two power of the product of two power of the scalar power spectrum. Now, there has been recently a lot of interest and study in a lot of interest in studying analytically this integral. See this literature that I leave here. And for instance, you can show that if the power spectrum is a Dirac delta peaked on K star, then the omega gravitational waves will be peaked at this value, with this typical shape. So this value is due to the fact that is a second order effect, and we are considering a gravitational wave generated during radiation domination. So this is square root of 3 comes from the speed of sound during radiation domination. And I used to plot the omega gravitational waves for a Dirac delta power spectrum, the plot from this paper, which is LISA Serendipity paper, because of the following fact, which I found very, very nice. Basically, if you have a curvature fluctuation, a curvature, an enhancement, sorry, in the curvature fluctuation, we generate a primordial mass distribution of the primordial black hole that is peaked around 10 to the minus 12, 10 to the minus 13, which is precisely where the bounds seems to allow for them to be dark, all the dark matter. Then you have for free the results in the stochastic background of gravitational waves will be peaked in the millihertz band, so where the LISA has its maximal sensitivity. And usually this shape that you see here is seen in the paper as an artifact of the fact that the power spectrum is a Dirac delta, is taken as a Dirac delta, and the results are more smooth. But in our case, where the power spectrum can be as steep, almost as steep as we want, we start to see in the omega gravitational wave here, the solid line, this structure. So these are the two models we show before, you see. And even more interesting, continuing on the studies on the analytics of these omega gravitational waves, you can see that if you have a power spectrum with two peaks, using this result of this author, you have an omega gravitational wave which is 3P, which is characterized by this 3-peak structure, which are related to the two peaks in the power spectrum, which ultimately are related to the microphysics happening in the multi-field scenario. Now, you can go even beyond. This is the power spectrum I showed before with multiple peaks, and you see that the resulting omega gravitational wave is quite exciting. It's basically almost the Dirac delta, the results in the envelope, plus oscillation on top of characteristic oscillation on top of that that we are studying right now. So to conclude, an enhancement of Courtauld perturbation during inflation leads to primordial black holes and gravitational wave signal, in principle detectable by LISA. And the proposed mechanism that I advertising here evade single field bounds on the steepness of the power spectrum, so how much the power spectrum scalar fluctuation can grow, is unique to multi-fluid inflation, and see again this paper, and it leads hopefully, as I show in the previous slide, to a characteristic signature in the stochastic background of gravitational waves. And another hope for the future is to study the effects from this distinctive pattern of non-Gaussianity, how it will affect both the signature in the stochastic background of gravitational waves and the mass distribution of primordial black holes. And just to leave you as with a last thought, one can say that through what I just said, that the gravitational waves could open a new window to probe multi-field effects during inflation that are hardly visible by studying non-Gaussianity at the CMB scale. And I stop here, and thanks for the attention.